Hello, I'm Dr. Balthazar, and after watching an episode of Ahsoka and shaking my head in disbelief at how Disney is somehow able to make sword fights of plasma laser swords between space samurai lame, I'm prescribing a film from yesteryear where the sword fights are actually quite badass. Akira Kurosawa's Yojimbo. Oh, how very topical and relevant in 2023, I hear you say. To which I reply, hey, shut your face.
Yeah. Come on, Yolanda, stay with me, baby.
But aside from the coolness of the sword fights, Yojimbo was and still is an influential movie by an influential director, Akira Kurosawa, with four remakes that I'm aware of, so it gives a wide range of looks to explore if remakes are a topic you wish to dive into. Which I do. Hollywood seems to be all about remakes these days, and while I don't think the notion is inherently an unworkable and stupid one, it is strangely difficult to do well. Anyway, I'm going to cover all that in a future video, like, subscribe, future content, blah blah blah, me, all that. In this video, I'm going to blather on about the original Yojimbo from 1961 with greater detail on plot and story than I plan to give its remakes, since none of them changed those things in really dramatic ways. Why it's a story that works and has inspired more remakes than your average bear, perhaps I can answer, or perhaps I cannot. You'll have to decide for yourself and hopefully watch the movie. It's worth a watch. In its time and place, finding movies that aren't written by imbeciles for imbeciles takes a bit of searching around.
Stupid! You're so stupid!
Giving a try to things that at a glance may not look like that thing is your thing. But maybe it is. Spoiler alert, this isn't a general recommendation video, it's an analytical one, because I have an analytical mind. So I'm going to break this thing down in detail because that's the sort of video I like to make. And this channel is a creative endeavor rather than a commercial one. And maybe I like the sound of my own voice a bit too much. We all have our shortcomings. The story opens in pre-Meiji era Japan, or before the westernization of Japan in the late 1800s, in which they brought a voluntary end to the samurai as a clearly defined social class. The protagonist, played by an actor named Toshiro Mifune, a legend in Japanese cinema, wanders the land without a clearly defined purpose. He literally tosses a stick in the air and follows the direction it points in when it lands. From the start, we need to acknowledge a few limitations tied to the context of the movie's production that are either deal breakers or not. It's black and white, which either you have an aversion to or you don't. If that's a bridge you can't cross, well, you do you, boo. It's also in subtitles, which means reading. If that's a problem,
take Tylenol for any headaches. Might offer any cramps.
Pause if you go cross-eyed, I guess. I don't know what to tell you there. Being functionally literate used to carry a negative stigma in my country. The good old days. Anyway, the music is also dated. Sounds that make sense to Eastern audiences don't go over well with Western ones. And 1961 was what it was for music. Just please stop. Number one on the billboards that year. Anyway, our hero rolls into a small town after witnessing a short interaction in which a father implores his son to work the farm while he insists on going off to be a gambler and live large. If you do watch the film, read Gambler as Gangster and Bodyguard as Mercenary. Those are probably more accurate translations. The mood is foreboding. We have a severed hand in a dog's mouth, which, if that's a typical thing in your neighborhood, well, goddamn.
Hardcore, man. Fucking hardcore.
And we're introduced to a corrupt constable establishing there isn't any official law and order in his town. A variety of lowlifes are free rein to misbehave. And a tavern keeper we'll call Grumpy Pants, who will serve as an ally to the protagonist at various points in the film, be it for plot or exposition purposes. Japanese names, like Russian names, tend to blur together for me, so I usually end up giving the characters my own names based on their predominant qualities. Also, the protagonist doesn't actually have a name. He deflects the question when someone asks him what his name is, saying he's a 30-year-old mulberry field, since that's about his age and he was looking at a mulberry field at that particular moment in time. It does sound kind of cool in Americanized Japanese. Sanjiro Kuwabatake. But I'm going to refer to him as Bad Motherfucker, since he's a bad motherfucker.
That's it. That's my bad motherfucker.
The dynamic of the town is laid out. A succession dispute has caused the central gang to splinter into two warring factions, who both have means of profiting through vice, political connections, hired thugs, and so on, so they effectively stalemate each other. There's a bit of a reference to Islam here. When the Prophet Muhammad died, there was a succession dispute over who should inherit his mantle. The actual bloodline in the form of a family member named Ali ibn Abi Talib, or his chief lieutenant and right-hand man, Abu Bakr. The followers of Ali went on to become the Shia sect of the Muslim religion, while the followers of Abu Bakr became the Sunni. The two rival factions in the film are basically the same thing. Directly relevant to understanding the film? No. But history nerds are nerds for history. It also becomes the basis of some of my naming patterns. Abu Bakr is a very cool name. We don't know what bad motherfucker's motives are early on. He may just be an opportunist who sees a situation to profit from by joining one side or the other as a mercenary, or using the film's terminology, a bodyguard. The Japanese word for bodyguard is Yojimbo, so that's where the title of the film comes from. It's also kind of a secondary name for the main character who has no name, just an alias. What kind of loser has an alias instead of a name? Wait a minute. He seems to have no loyalties other than himself and no moral opposition to committing acts of murder, though it's suggested he may have some sort of moral code that he lives by. We'll have to wait and see if this is someone we actually can get behind. The film takes an interesting approach to character development. In truth, this character isn't going to change or develop over the course of the film, but rather our understanding of him is what's going to change. His values are revealed over time, rather than transformed in response to events, which is hard to do well in a film. If we feel like we know what the protagonist is all about, if their motives and moral compass are clear from the start and don't undergo change, we can predict almost any behavior that isn't a contrivance. Which can work if they're really cool.
You son of a bitch!
But coolness with an audience is tough to predict, and can age badly. Protagonists will often go on some kind of transformative journey during the film out of necessity. If the main character doesn't develop in some way, well, what does? Are we seeing a story, or a series of random events and set pieces? Yeah, I'm looking at you, Disney. That the filmmakers are able to transform the audience's perspective of the protagonist across the movie, rather than transform the protagonist himself, is pretty cool in my humble opinion. Bad Motherfucker establishes that he's a master swordsman by smoking three thugs, sending a message with authority to the two gangs that he's an asset they're going to want to have. So why do these sword fights work, and the nonsense in Star Wars just not so much? Well, I think there's two factors at play, speed and lethality. Swords of any type are dangerous weapons. It doesn't take more than a grazing blow to take an opponent out of the mix. The more you marginalize the lethality of the blade, the less tension you're going to have when someone wields one. Penetrating blow, center mass, and you don't die. Okay then. Speed also plays into it. Kendo is a very cool Japanese sport with bamboo swords that pantomime sword fighting without leaving its participants on death's door. A kendo match is going to be slower than an actual sword fight, with deliberate back and forth moments as points are accumulated. It's a difference between a thing and people playing at a thing in a safe and controlled way. Yojimbo fights with swords the way swordsmen fight with swords. Most other films fight with swords the way kendo fights with bamboo. Star Wars fights with swords the way children fight with wiffle ball bats.
Meanwhile, back at the classy clambake.
Anyway, back to the film. So a bad motherfucker joins the Ali faction, and we find that the brains of the operation is actually the wife of the boss. We'll call her the Good Wife, and their faction the Good Wife's faction from here on out. In 2023, a strong female character would have to be the same as a strong male character. If Bad Motherfucker smoked three dudes with a sword, she'd have to smoke four dudes with a bigger sword. God, the movies coming out now are just terrible. But in 1961, she's able to show her strength by her cunning, her ability to influence others to her ends, her ability to think tactically. Anyway, the faction plans to utilize Bad Motherfucker for a frontal assault on the enemy at high noon, and then kill him afterwards to avoid paying him the king's ransom he negotiated to join their side. The showdown between the two factions takes shape, and Bad Motherfucker promptly deserts, revealing he knew about the plan to kill him all along. And here we see he's more than a skilled swordsman, he's a thinker. He joined a side to provoke a confrontation that would break the stalemate in hopes they would wipe each other out. He also demanded a crazy sum of money for his services because he knew the swordsmen who possessed similar combat abilities as he would be jealous of the pay imbalance between their otherwise equal talents, efforts, and implied risks. As an aside to the ladies out there who place greater value on pay equality than pay equity, terms you can do your own research on if you have such a mind to, I'll just offer one word of caution. Being paid on a scale of, say, 10 years experience by adding 5 years actual experience to 5 years of stay-at-home parenting, or being paid on a higher scale as those with the same experience to receive full-time pay in exchange for part-time hours, which allows you to have more favorable childcare benefits, be forewarned. Establishing perceived equality through actual inequity breeds bitter resentment and contempt. It always has. It's a question for society as a collective whole to decide on and the members of the republic to honor and abide by if it ever comes to the legislature. But you may find the idea of being resented in a general way to be very different than being resented by your peers in an immediate way. And keeping the most competent workers when they feel slighted is nigh impossible. Competence always creates options and opportunities. It's the incompetent who never seem to fuck off back into the ether. Don't say I didn't warn you.
Good luck with that.
Meanwhile, back at the classy clambake.
Anyway, the most dangerous swordsmen in the gangs peaced out before the conflict began for this very reason. That's the art of fighting without fighting right there.
The art of fighting without fighting?
The opposition has an asset you want to remove, but there are many ways to do so that don't involve direct conflict. We're talking Sun Tzu and the Art of War 101. This is a theme in the movie. Physical power, advanced combat skills, a technology edge, and weaponry. All are good assets, but it's the tactical thinker that's the most dangerous. Well, for the most part anyway. Bad motherfucker swordsmanship is kind of the neutron bomb, which undermines my premise a little bit, but I'm sticking to it.
Then you, my dear friend, are a damn fool!
The showdown itself is a bit of comedy, as well as effective world-building. Both sides are terrified and do little to hide the fact. It's the posturing and bravado of the coward at its finest. Word eventually comes down that a local inspector is coming to town, so everyone uses it as an excuse to peace out on this idea, which is effective world-building for two reasons. The first is unless you're Seattle, Washington in 2020, you can't just murder people in broad daylight without some consequences. Nor would you wish to unless you're a psychopath. Even in late feudal Japan, there are authority figures and societal norms that have to be observed if the narrative is set in a believable world. The second is human beings don't enjoy engaging in slaughter. In most American action films, characters don't mind over much when they face a violent death in the near future, or care over much when they commit acts of murder. Modern combat zones involve the use of technology, where you may see a body drop at the pull of a trigger, probably you won't. Medieval combat with sword and spear was face-to-face, eyeball-to-eyeball. The human body is 60% water. We are bags of blood, and when pierced by a slashing or stabbing instrument, people die badly. They scream, maybe in a language you fully comprehend. They beg for life as their insides spill into the outside, and you are the one who did it to them. Battlefields transform into nightmare scenes of blood and gore in a visceral way. Human physiology has changed little over time, and I haven't come across any historians of Bronze or Steel Age warfare who have made a decent argument that combat fatigue, PTSD, or psychological trauma found in wartime combatants were any less common in those time periods than today. If anything, they were worse. This is a believable conflict between two groups of impoverished mercenaries who don't want to die today, setting the film in a world that is foreign in time and place, but believable in its human responses. Good world building there. As a historical aside, you may be thinking this is some kind of deconstruction of samurai combat, but not really. The common tropes associated with samurai is they're single-minded in their loyalty to their liege lord, fearless in their quest for an honorable death in combat, and the katana blade is essentially the soul of the samurai. Pre-Meiji Japan was a feudal society. In Europe, the feudal social stratum was the aristocratic landowners on top, headed by a king or emperor, a warrior class of knights beneath them, and a peasant class of farmers below them. In Japan, it's a daimyo class of landowners on top, headed by a shogun, a warrior class of samurai beneath them, and a peasant class of farmers below them. The era in which Japanese samurais fought in actual wars was during the Sengoku period, from about 1467 to 1603. The start time gets a little muddy depending on how you want to subdivide the eras of Japanese history. But it ended when Tokugawa Ieyasu won the civil wars and established a shogunate that enjoyed internal peace and closed borders until 1867, when the shogunate came to a voluntary end. There's a stark contrast between what a samurai was and was conceptualized as before and after 1603. Very few battles during the Sengoku period came off without some faction on one side or the other going over to the other side. You can read the journals of samurais from the period. They mostly say, mosquitoes are hellish, the other side looked really strong, so we ran away. Nobody used a sword if they could stay on a horse and fire a bow and arrow. So what changed? Well, what does a warrior class do for about 250 years when it isn't fighting wars? In Japan, they wrote poetry about how brave they would be if they did fight those wars. Fearless in battle, the glory and honor of dying a warrior's death, that sort of thing. The children and grandchildren of soldiers are the ones who glorify the wars their forebears fought. The actual combatants, not so much. Also, what ideas would a shogunate that had emerged from 150 years of civil wars propagandize to ensure no repetition of that nightmare? Undying loyalty to liege lord, of course. We'll have no more of that disloyal bullshit, thank you. Why the sword instead of the bow? Well, actually, I don't know on that one. Maybe Freud was right after all.
And I see your Schwartz is as big as mine.
Anyway, the behaviors of the samurai in this film may not seem like the behaviors of typical samurai archetypes, because those archetypes were literary concepts meant to embody what Japanese society wished to believe was their cultural center in the late 19th and early 20th century, not because the historical record supports it. Like I said before, history nerds, can you dig it?
Can you dig it?
So the first act ends with the presence of the inspector forcing a temporary truce. Bad motherfucker almost got the two sides to wipe each other out, but it's not going to be that easy. There's an inertia to this conflict that likes to keep reasserting itself. Another character is introduced as a big bad. Abu Bakr has two brothers, one of which we've seen and the other has now made his entrance. I see a real influence on Frank Herbert's science fiction story Dune, We have the main leader of one of the two factions similar to Baron Harkonnen, with two family members as his chief lieutenants, one a bull of a man with power and physical strength, but no intelligence to speak of, like Beast Raban. The other a handsome and unimposing figure like Fade Rautha, who happens to be the greater threat between the two brothers, because he's the thinker. It's the thinkers, not the fighters, to be feared. He also possesses an advantage in weapon technology. He has a pistol, so we'll call him Gunslinger. Maybe they could have made him a sword fighter with the similar level of skill as Bad Motherfucker, making you wonder who would win in a direct fight between them. But this works too as a plot device, in that Bad Motherfucker has to account for the range weapon that nullifies his melee weapon if used properly. It changes the dynamic of each gang's assets and liabilities. There's also the symbolism of an iconic Japanese weapon going up against an iconic American weapon that would have resonated with Japanese audiences in post-World War II Japan. As an aside, the American in me kind of scoffs at the size of the firearm. I don't know what caliber that is, but it's not exactly a dirty, hairy hand cannon, is it?
Being this is a .44 Magnum, the most powerful handgun in the world, and would blow your head clean off.
Oh, that's cute. That's so adorable. We got so much in common. This is so cute.
So the temporary peace comes to an end when Abu Bakr, as a magistrate, murdered some miles away, drawing off the inspector. Bad Motherfucker discovers the assassins drinking away their guilt, committing the murder. A human response that makes sense if your world building is meant to be grounded in believability rather than absurdity. So the suit is bulletproof? Okay, right, whatever. Anyway, Bad Motherfucker subdues them and hands them over to the opposing gang to use as leverage against the Abu Bakr faction. The Good Wife side tried the extortion bit, using the informants as leverage to unbalance the stalemate. But Gunslinger and Beast Raban kidnap the Good Wife's bitch-made beta male son, and a hostage exchange is set up. At the exchange, Gunslinger just blasts the informants because why not? Silencing them is the goal, not getting them back. Who cares? But the Good Wife pulls out another hostage that comes a bit out of left field. It's some baby girl who's roped up that the Abu Bakr faction seems to care about for reasons unknown. So we have another hostage exchange that goes off without anyone getting smoked. The stalemate that threatened to pop off resumes its state of inertia. It's hard to unbalance long-running stalemates. And some exposition with Grumpy Pants brings us up to speed on who Baby Girl is. I wonder if any of this could have been foreshadowed in some way, or a little more groundwork laid on this plot twist, though I see a reason for why it's all being introduced at this point, since it adds some moral questions to the Bad Motherfucker's decision-making, and some different stakes of the conflict. Anyway, Baby Girl has a husband that ran up gambling debts, so they took his wife and gave her to a political contact, who rapes her while her husband listens from across the street. Wait, what? Jesus fucking Christ!
Jesus Christ, dude!
That's just... Jesus. I figured it was someone's sister or something. God damn, it's fucking awful. I said earlier Bad Motherfucker didn't transform as a character. Rather, our understanding of his character transformed. We weren't sure if he had any kind of moral code. We've learned he does by working the two gangs against one another. But we don't know if his code extends to helping others. He's a stoic character that hasn't shown much affection for people in general, and his only response to the exposition on Baby Girl's plight was loathing for the cowardice of her husband in letting that happen. I mean, yeah, no shit, dude. Jesus fucking Christ. His plan thus far has been to eliminate the gang factions by playing a dangerous game of pitting the two sides against each other. If he complicates the plan by trying to save this random girl, he could get himself killed. It's a morality question of prioritizing self or others, and nobility has its costs. What will he do? Well, we'll have to wait and see, since the director doesn't feel the need to answer every question a nanosecond after it's posed. Bad Motherfucker joins up with the Abu Bakr faction and goes with Beast Raban to check on the girl to make sure she's properly protected, since she's kind of a MacGuffin now that both sides want possession of from here on out. Raban is something of a comedy figure, which admittedly is low-hanging fruit with the buck teeth and the unibrow. He's cartoonishly dumb, but I'm okay with some comedy and action films as long as Taikiki Waititi, whatever his fucking name is, isn't involved in the project. Or anyone from Marvel's Phase 4, but especially the child and his girlfriend. So Bad Motherfucker tells Raban the six guards they stationed to watch the girl have been killed and to run for help, and then he smokes the fuck out of the six guards. I get there isn't blood and gore and all that with these sequences, but come on, these sword fights are awesome. Tom Cruise and company use them as the basis for their fight choreography in The Last Samurai for a reason. The family unit is reunited, husband and wife and child escape to a lifetime of guilt and coping. End Act 2. When Act 3 opens up, the gang war is tuned up to Volume 10. The desire to conduct the war without cutting too deeply into business profits has gone by the wayside. The town is basically a war zone, and the bodies are piling up. Bad Motherfucker's role in freeing the girl is revealed. Nobility has its cost, as I said before. He's captured, imprisoned, and pounded into oblivion. He makes an escape from the storehouse that feels a bit contrived. He hops in a trunk. The guards think he escaped and run off, leaving the door wide open for him to crawl out of. It's thin, but yeah, you have to get him out of there somehow in a reduced physical condition. And again, the thinker is a dangerous one in this game. Abu Bakr's side learned the girl isn't recoverable and tuned it up to volume 11 in our drive toward the finale. They set fire to the Good Wife faction's house and slaughter everyone. One faction down, one to go. I will concede that the swordplay doesn't work in this scene. It's sloppy at best, but at this point you've either bought into the film or stopped watching anyway. Bad Motherfucker recovers, as evidenced by his ability to throw a dagger with great precision, a skill that could have been introduced before the finale since it kind of looks like it means something here. And upon hearing of Grumpy Pan's capture for assisting in his escape, he returns to town for the final showdown. Repetition of movies is a useful device. It allows for comparison. Look how different things are now than they were before. We had a showdown at high noon earlier in the film. The town was intact, the combatants terrified of the combat. We have another showdown at high noon. The town is in ruins, and the combatants are way past fucking around. Bad Motherfucker cancels out the technology advantage possessed by Gunslinger by throwing a dagger into his shooting arm. Also a bit thin, I will concede. I'm not sure I ever completely got behind the gun anyway, but the device served its intended purpose narrative-wise, changed up the dynamic in Act 2, and he mows down everyone on Abu Bakr's side, except the son from back at the start of the film, who thought being a gangster was more glamorous than being a farmer. He sends the kid back to his mother, and the movie wraps up with a few comments and Japanese cultural references that went completely over my head.
Nothing goes over my head. My reflexes are too fast. I would catch.
In summary, the plot makes sense. And while the characters can be difficult to distinguish in the first third of the movie, they're believable in their fears, ambitions, and actions. Our understanding of the protagonist develops over the course of the narrative. The world building is strong, there are understandable rules that restrain behaviors, and the escalation of violence moves in stages in response to changing conditions, rather than just not happening until it's convenient to happen. There's a morality theme in which our protagonist is no less violent than the villains, but is morally just because he adheres to a code that involves sacrificing himself for others. Also, the theme of the movie of the strategist being more dangerous than the arm of the warrior is there, unless I'm Rorschaching this thing. All that being said, the groundwork is now laid for a companion video that compares and contrasts this film to its remakes. If you're still listening in, thank you so much. You're the best. Love your face. Hope you enjoyed the video. I had a lot of fun making it. I'm Dr. Balthazar. Like what you like, don't what you don't. It's all your call, Kemosabe. Take it easy, everyone.